a match being so looked forward to by people all over the country?
Well, yeah, the top two teams, without a shadow of a doubt, and they're playing for the rubber the third time. Liam here was in charge for the last 2 years. First time in, unlucky enough to be beaten. Second time in, won it. And now they're going for two in a row. People could say they'll be going for three in a row. Kilkenny, after their fantastic feats, will not want to be going out second time losing to Tip again. And it promised to be a great game. I really believe that Kilkenny will try to stop. If Tip run into an early lead, Michael, at 5 or 6 points, they're so young and exuberant and kind of full of vim that they could push on. But Kilkenny will try to close down early on and make it kind of very physical and keep it nice and tight and stay in the game and then just edge ahead if they're able.
Well, Liam, obviously for the last 2 years you were here at Croke Park in a very different capacity. How does it feel to be on the panel here today instead of down beside the pitch there?
Yeah, it's a little bit different. You know, it's a great occasion. It's a great honour to be asked to manage your own county team. So last 2 years it was a great experience for us all. But you know, it's game on really again today. Two great teams. You know, I guess from when people left Croke Park last year, I guess most of the neutrals would have said, wouldn't it be great to get a third under it? So the trilogy is what we'd probably call it now, and it's third time, and it's all to play for here again today. Huge amount at stake for both teams.
When you're involved in it, as you were for the last 2 years as a manager, you're caught up in the whole thing. It's all about the routine, about everything that you have to do. But I sense in you the tension of the day today.
Yeah, a little bit, yeah. Yeah, but you know, you do get attached, obviously, yeah. You know, being involved and being down in the dressing room, you know, whatever about coming into the match, whether you're sitting up here, whether you're sitting in the stand, to actually be down in the dressing room with the lads and preparing them to go into battle with 82,000 people watching, you know, it's a fabulous opportunity for both teams again today. I mean, every guy that starts out in an intercounty championship panel this year, they all wanted to be here on the first Sunday in September. And for Tipperary and Kilkenny, they're the ones that get the honour of going out there today.
Let the battle commence, said Micheál Murathaí in the opening piece there, Tomás Mulcahy. And that's what people are expecting here today. They are expecting a battle.
They are, Michael. And the thing about this All-Ireland final, I mean, for non-GA or non-hurling followers all over the country, they're all clued into this one. They all want to sit down at 3:30 to watch this one. The rugby players or the rugby fans and stuff like that, because what they've seen over the last 2 years has been fantastic. And you mentioned, Liam, about being kind of attached or detached from the scene and stuff like that. I saw him checking his watch and we heard that the Tip team hadn't arrived yet. Maybe last year he'd have been in a gap at this stage. And also, yeah, that's all part and parcel of it. And like Gareth Edwards, the great Welsh scrum half, was here maybe 2 years ago. Micheál Murathaí asked him what did he think of the game of hurling here. He was here in All-Ireland and finally said he'd never seen anything like it. It was truly awesome. And Micheál went on to ask him, would he like to be down there with a hurling? He said, I certainly wouldn't like to be down there without one. And that's what the nature of today is going to be on the basis. Like, it is no place for the faint-hearted. We're expecting a huge, huge battle. And if we get anything like we had in the last 2 years, I think everybody would be happy.
That's a very good story, Tomás. It was actually me in 1983 that he was talking
about. All right. Was it? Okay. Well, he was here 2 years ago as well. Beyond.
Is it going to be very physical today?
Yeah, that's the nature of the game. These two teams are a very physical side and they play that way. Like, the last 2 years have been very physical and like, no quarter given, no quarter taken. But you'd have to say no red cards either, and that's the way it should be. We don't want a little kind of... If you want to play tennis or golf, that's fine. This is our own game and this is special. And I expect it today to be that way. But like, Brian Gavin, the referee, the rules are there, and like, the game, if the game flows, I hope there's no one sent off, because no one wants to have a hard luck story. You need 15 going against 15 and that's the way it'll be, hopefully. And like, the best team is going to win, but the bragging rights in this are unreal, because as Liam said there, like, it's the trilogy, and like, the winter is very short in Wind All-Ireland, and as Liam will tell you, when you lose one, the winter is very long. Yeah, yeah. And like, you know, there's a big lot at stake. I feel it's more at stake in a sense for Kilkenny. They've won so much, because if they go out kind of losing two, you remember yourself, the ones you lost and the ones you won, whereas Tip seem to be on just the start of a new era, whereas Kilkenny are trying to hold in there and build one again. So like, it's all to play for. And again, like, whoever you're probably going to find, Michael, at the end of the day, that is a mistake somewhere or other is going to win the game.
Yeah, it may just be the case. Well, after the last two All-Ireland final encounters between Tip and Kilkenny, most of the players today know exactly what the procedure is in terms of the schedule of the day. However, it is, of course, as we were saying, a daunting occasion. So we decided to ask a former All-Ireland winning captain to count us down through hurling final day.
Yeah, we're here under the Hogan, and it's kind of a magic place, but it's quiet and it's cold and it's lonesome enough if you want, bar your teammates are with you, but the other bus is probably parked behind you. You'd get off the bus there and, you know, there'd be just a wall of people coming in, and it was the old dressing rooms underneath the Hogan there, and it was magic. That, I always found that was magic to live. I dreamt about being in those days, and to live through that was just incredible. It's about 20 past two now, and an hour and 10 minutes to go to throw in. So you're landing here, and I always just describe this place as a sanctuary. It's where you are yourself, and it's the quietness, the stillness, the little chance to just to be together. And when I came here with Claire, I was captain, and sometimes I get a fitted speech, and most times I didn't say a word. And you'd be just so worried about the fellow you're marking and your own contribution to the day. Well, you leave inside, and where you know, hang your clothes and everything else, and you come in here now. So it's a fantastic facility. It has to be said, like, it's the envy of every dressing room in the country, really, to have a place like this with AstroTurf. And this is really the key area, I think, that where other dressing rooms around the country now, it's all about just you have one of your dressing room. This is really the place that, you know, fellas get the sweat up. So we'd leave by this door. It probably wouldn't be opened as gently as that, but it'll be flung back. You start to feel the heat, and you start to feel the crowd, and a bit different now for me coming out as manager. I'd been nearly last out, but coming out as a player down, I suppose, the bottom corner of the Hogan and the Canal, I was captain, and that was a different feeling. I was forced out, so you were forced to meet the wall of noise, and that was incredible. It was an absolutely incredible feeling. It's either, look, it gets to you and you don't perform, or you lap it up and you say, I love this, I want to be here, and you go for it. And I think most of our team went for it anyway. And if you get as far as here, you're in God's own country, as we'd say. You know, you're in business if you're going up to collect Liam McCarrig, and you're coming up here, and you meet the president, and the president coming, Luke Lashgale, and just the stuff you've dreamed about when you were a boy, I guess, and just coming through in front of your own eyes, and it was just the most amazing thing I've ever gone through, to be honest.
Yeah, Anthony Daly's fond recollection of All-Ireland final day. Well, as a Clare man, I know Marty Morrissey has fond memories about those glory days as well. But of course, today is all about the supporters of Tip and Kilkenny.
Absolutely, Michael. Great memories there from previous All-Irelands. And as you say, this is all about Tipperary and Kilkenny, and they've arrived on Jones's Road. Are you going to win this All-Ireland?
Yes, by 2 or 3 points. Guaranteed of it. We're taking Ian back to where it belongs, back to Northside.
Dreaming.
Who's going to be man of the match?
Henry. He's going to make amends for last year. King Henry is back.
OK, well, what about Tipperary? You were busy with it.
My wife is due her second child on Tuesday, so best wishes to Phyllis. And now, let's say, if the Tip win at the end of it, we'll all be very happy.
Go on, the brilliant!
Fortunately for today's All-Ireland hurling final, as you can see, that's exactly the case. I know, sir, it was raining earlier on in Galway. The rain has been moving from the west, moving to the east coast here. So, obviously, umbrellas and hats and flags and scarves and everything will be employed today in what unfortunately looks like it's going to be a wet All-Ireland final. You never know, we might get a little bit of a break later on. Well, as for the teams, I suppose they know the routine by now. Exactly when to arrive here at Croke Park, when to get togged out, when to begin their warm-up. And I guess the only thing that the only two teams don't know is who is going to be leaving with the cup today. All right, now let's get the views of two men who will be out here on the pitch very shortly. 12 months ago, one had the experience of being denied a place in sporting history as part of the five in a row. The other had the experience of helping to prevent it.
For as the five in a row last year, I suppose we were hot favourites going into that game against Tipperary. Everyone was expected maybe a win. To be fair to the people of Kilkenny, they're saying we've done enough. You know, we've done a lot the last couple of years, but at the same time, you know, we're playing our neighbours, the history, the rival, everything that's there.
It was hard earned, I suppose, to stop Kilkenny from doing five in a row, which was a very special thing in itself. But if you don't back it up this year, you're right, you do start to say to yourself, well, we don't want to be this one-hit wonder, like, you know, that you blaze in, stop someone from winning something, and then get off the scene again.
you know, the whole four in a row thing is wiped now, you know, so it's a clean slate again, starting from scratch.
It's not really the norm for Tipperary to get to three All-Ireland finals in a row, so I mean, it's a fantastic achievement in itself, but it's important to be winning them as well, and I think the crop of players we have at the moment understand how to win in Croke Park, but understand what's needed to do to mind yourself on and off the field, I suppose, to perform at your best in there.
Any time you play Wexford, you know, and these local teams, they're just, you know, it's so hard to play them.
And Hogan has pace, and he cracks it into the back of the net.
It's great to have him down there instead of Croke Park, because Croke Park, you might have maybe 20,000 places nearly empty, and down Wexford Park, you know, you'll hear it and you'll get it, and there's people, like, practically on the line, you know, shouting at you. But that was an exciting game, and, you know, we had a good win that day, and it was a good start to our campaign.
All the way down in, Lark Corbett's reading it, Corbett's in, and Corbett scores!
Just put it down as a freak game. Larry ran out to balls that day. If Larry knew to dress him after the match, a ball would land in his hand. Do you know what I mean? It was that kind of a day, you know, where everything went right. And Waterford just kind of collapsed in on themselves then, and they sat back and sat back. And of course, if you do that probably against our forward line, you're inviting trouble.
From league final, I suppose we owe these boys one, definitely.
Back towards Larkin, coming in at the angle. Goal!
I didn't do a few points in the end, but we're glad to get the win, you know, and we knew ourselves the hunger was there, and, you know, we're on the right road.
The 5-week delay coming into the All-Ireland semi-final was a help this time round, because it allowed that euphoria to dampen down. It allowed us to watch the video a good bit of the game and say, look, well, these were mistakes Waterford made more so than genius from us. Us with Dublin, obviously, we had that huge battle with them, you know, and physically they were really, really strong.
First ball into Billy Kelly, Corbett is sniffing.
We did get that huge boost from that. I think it is something we definitely needed. A lot of sore bodies after the game, but a lot of satisfaction as well in beating Dublin.
Semi-final against Waterford, yeah, another local game again. We went in after that game, there was an award said, which was a bit strange, and one lad said to me, you swear we lost. Performance itself wasn't great, but I think we've done enough. And it's just, you know, we've worked hard the last 2 weeks there now, and hopefully we've enough done.
There's no one moment, maybe. You can look back and give yourself great satisfaction. Yeah, we beat Kilkenny, we got back-to-back. That'd be amazing for us as Tipperary players. Obviously, for supporters and pundits and all looking in, and it'll be all around, this could be the defining moment for either county. Whatever happens at 5:30 on the Sunday evening of the final, both counties are going to be as strong again next year.
You know, we lost last year inside in Croke Park, and it's very hard to take. And, you know, the crowd that stayed there, you know, and the speech and everything with it, and it's, you know, it brings back hurtful memories.
Kilkenny certainly, I suppose, would say that they have an edge because of this hunger and being beaten last year, and their dream, I suppose, of 5 in a row being taken away.
It's a killer fine team to lose in an All-Ireland final day, but 2 years in a row, it'll just be traumatic, to be honest. So, you know, that's in the back of our minds too, and, you know, we just have to give it our all.
Nothing else matters, I think, in any of the players' lives, only 3:30 on that day, and going after each other, hell for leather.
Yeah, Kilkenny's Michael Fennelly and Tip goalkeeper Brendan Cummins. Now, we've had the destination of one cup decided already. The Irish Press Cup has been claimed by the Miners. And talking about last year and the significance and so on. Be a big blow to Kilkenny and to Brian Cody to lose another All-Ireland to Tip.
Absolutely. I mean, they're going to, you know, I guess they talk about stepping back and having a go. Like, I mean, what you're going to see here, I'd say, in the first 15 minutes is going to be very raw. I think, you know, Kilkenny are, you know, the hurt of losing a final, I guess we experienced it ourselves in 2009. And, you know, it does drive you on. So they're going to be a driven bunch today, there's no doubt about it. You know, and it'll be very interesting to see how that first 15 minutes goes, because I think both teams would love to have a 4 or 5 point. I mean, Tipperary grabbed a 5 point lead last year in the first 10 minutes, and that was a platform that they needed to build on. You know, and I think they drove on from there. You know, whereas this year now again, you know, who's going to win the battle in the first 10, 15 minutes? Who's going to put the marker down early? And I think that's where it's really going to be intriguing today, in the first 10, 15 minutes.
It is. Any danger that it might spill over, Tomás?
Yeah, there is a danger, and that's where the referee, Brian Gavin, will come into play. You know, we'd all love to see the open style of hurling that we all like to watch, and the hard physical content in the game itself. But, I mean, he will have to maybe flash one or two yellow cards later on if it does get out of hand. But look, Michael, we've seen the last 2 years. I mean, it's been hard, it's been fair. They give it their best shot, they get off the field and they shake hands with each other afterwards. And that's what we expect from these two great teams. And you go back over the last 2 years, Tipperary would have felt, we should have won it 2 years ago. Kilkenny now are coming back in and they're saying, OK, we didn't have a fully fit Henry Shefflin last year. Yeah. When he went off, the difference in the team once he went off the field. And so there's so much at stake here, right? You have a fully fit Henry coming back into the play. You have Mr. Hogan back at centre-back, wasn't there either last year. I mean, he is a huge plus now for Kilkenny on that side of it. And it's all about... Liam mentioned about raw, and it's about this aggression and wanting to win it more than the opposition. That's where it's going to be at. You will see the game open up maybe into the second half period with more chances, but expect it to be very tight. in the opening phases.
Very tight it's going to be. We're headed for a commercial break here on the programme. Now, when we come back...
This year, there's less sort of talk about things this year because, you know, it took on life of its own from the point of view of all this, you know, five in a row thing, and that's gone. And this year it's more straightforward, I suppose, really. But we got to the league final, which is, I suppose, you know, a decent thing to do at the end of the day, and, you know, Dublin were the opposition. But on the day, Dublin blues away in lots of ways. After that game, I suppose, there was much kind of wondering, where are Kilkenny? And that was understandable too. We don't have to kind of justify ourselves to anybody else, but we have to be kind of give ourselves a standard to reach and a standard to aspire to. And also, you need a confidence. Every team needs a confidence about themselves, you know, that they're there and they're going to be very, very difficult to beat. Watford have the ability to beat us when we're playing well even. But, you know, winning is, I suppose, an art in itself. And, I mean, it's about grinding it out and getting there. I don't think we played particularly well, certainly for the full 70 minutes. But, you know, the object of the exercise was achieved. Would it be good enough to win the All-Ireland final? Not a hope. Tipperary, it was never a doubt, I suppose, that they would get to the final.
They are coming to sniffing, and the ball is in the next.
I'm not interested in twos or threes or fours or anything else in a row at all. I'm just interested in the match that's going on right now, the next game, and that's there. And if Tipperary are good enough to beat us on the day, that's the way sport works. And we know they probably are, but we also feel that we're good enough to beat them on a particular day as well. So it's game on, and it's not about records, it's not about what you go on to win, it's about on the day. And it's a massive game to be looking forward to.
Yeah, the thoughts of the Kilkenny manager, Brian Cody, ahead of today's final. Liam Sheedy, what do you think of Brian Cody?
An amazing man. An amazing man. I mean, he still has the drive, he still has the energy, he still has the enthusiasm to be at the helm there in Kilkenny. He's done a fabulous job with that team. I mean, he's probably built two teams over the years, you know. I mean, he keeps on bringing in new guys. And, you know, he's definitely totally focused on today. I mean, I see him getting off the bus there, and he just looks like a man that's in the zone here. He was very, very hurt, obviously. I think a lot of things worked against him last year with the way the injuries were coming up to the match. And obviously, there's a bit of a circus building with the five in a row. So I think they've probably learned to say, let's keep this low-key. I think the build-up this year for Kilkenny has been very, very low-key. Like, they went on holidays in November. They were, you know, they went early, so that they were getting back, I'd say, from the 1st of January. There's only one place they wanted to be, and that's in here in Croke Park today. And they're back there, and Tip are going to have to play extremely, extremely well to beat them. But, you know, that, as I said, that's what makes today just so, so intriguing.
When you go head-to-head with somebody like that, as you did for 2 years, and the prize is so high, does it get personal?
No, not at all. I mean, myself and Brian were lucky to share an All-Stars trip together, and we'd have a great camaraderie, you know, at that stage. So
I was on that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, but at the end of the day, when you're a manager of a team, you want your team to win, and, like, that's the bottom line. And, you know, we were, Tipperary were lucky, I guess, to get over the line in 2010, and Kilkenny have enjoyed huge success over the last 4 years. But again, today, you know, irrespective of the, you know, the four that you win previous, all becomes, you know, it's all about 2011 now. And it's the same for Tip, you know, you won the match in 2010. It's all about 2011. It's all about today. And both teams wanted to say, right, well, you know, we are the All-Ireland champions in 2011. And that's what both teams want to capture today. And Brian Cody, as I said, is a man driven.
This is a kind of a defining game for Brian Cody, Cyril, in the sense that he has been such a fabulous manager, as Liam said. I mean, the record book would speak for itself. And yet, to lose two All-Irelands in a row would just put a blot in it, wouldn't it?
He's been the icon of a hurling manager, as Liam said. Like, what he's done has been fantastic. He's very grounded. You know, he's very, very kind of down-to-earth. His secret is no secret. Like, a few years ago, Michael, he was in All-Ireland, they were saying, what was his secret to success? The secret was, like, it was so simple. And now, like, again, he will not want to go out, you know, losing two All-Irelands. But as he said himself, if they're good enough on the day, they'll win. And if they're not, you have to take them things as well. And, like, on the sideline, like, Liam has been there and Brian has been there and I've been there as well. You will get animated at times and you'll be, you know, you'll do anything to win. But when it's over, you're not there to make enemies. In actual fact, your greatest competitor is going to be your best friend when it's all said and done. Now, this promises to be a great final. But really, when the boys go inside the white line, when the players go in there, really you're dependent on the players to perform. They have to die for you. You know what I mean? And, like, that's what's going to count. But all good managers have that. The players are willing to die for the cause. And, like, that's what it's going to take again today. And, like, it's going to take something extra. But, like, one big thing now, Michael, has happened. You referred to it earlier on, the rain.
Yeah.
The cogs are vital at this stage. Because Croke Park, when it gets wet, unlike Torres or anywhere else, it doesn't get soft. It'll get actually faster.
Yes,
but it does get slippier. So, like, you know, you saw the minors now. This is going to be, like, it'll be much more so for the seniors. So, like, whoever's able to adopt them slippery conditions will have a bit, you know, will probably win the game.
All right. OK, so we've heard from the Kilkenny manager, Brian Cody. Well, he has a new opposite number on the sideline this year. Declan Ryan has taken over from Liam here, of course, as the Tip manager. Declan, an All-Ireland winner himself and an All-Star. Now, we spoke to him recently about growing up with the proud tradition of Tip hurling in his veins.
Declan Ryan again on the 40, creating menace and havoc.
We were all brought up in the hurling field in Tlaunty, I suppose, as young lads. From the time I was able to walk, I had a hurling man, and I always loved belting the ball around the place at home and that.
Beautiful skill. And Ryan taking that pass from Cleary, puts it over the bar.
It's at the very core of our society in Tipperary. Taking on the Tip job, I suppose, was a huge challenge and a great honour, of course, but it certainly was a huge challenge, but we were confident that if we could get the players playing at the right level, that, you know, it'll take a good performance to beat this team, you know. And
but why did you take on the challenge, Declan? Because most people would say they're all Ireland champions. No, there's only one way, and it's going down.
Well, I suppose part of the reason we took it on was that we were very familiar with all the younger guys that are coming through and Tip there. And we know that they're winners in their hearts. You know, they're great men first of all, and they're great sports people secondly, and they're great men to work with. And you know, what have we brought to the team itself? I'd like to think that we have brought some maybe stability, and that we like these guys to play with a bit of confidence, and you know, and just to play to their best on a given day. And if they do that, well, then they'll be difficult to beat.
Is there anything that concerns you?
Well, I don't think we've put a full 75 minute performance together this year yet. We know it's in the team. We know they're physically good enough to do it for 75 minutes or whatever it takes. Brian Cody's record is phenomenal when you think about it. You know, the commitment and the time and the success he has had has been, it's a savage achievement. Kilkenny have a lot of super players, probably the best players that ever play the game. They'll be playing in Croke Park on Allan final day, but both teams will know that they have a very, very realistic chance of winning the Liam McCarthy Cup. I think the last 2 years they've been fantastic games, but I don't think they're going to have any bearing on this game. That both teams will go in knowing they have a 50-50 chance, and if they're hungry enough on the day, and if the ball runs for whichever team, you know, they'll probably have the best chance of winning it. The players will have to realise that they've put a huge effort into getting to All-Ireland final day. And that they have to go out and they have to be the best that they can be on the day. The important thing is that you turn up fit and focused and ready for battle. And you know, as I've said already, these guys in Tip, they're able to play at a very high level. And we'll see that on our Ireland final day.
Yeah, that, of course, the Tip manager, Declan Ryan. Time to get some further thoughts on today's match. We're going to head downstairs where Claire McNamara is waiting to join us, along with two men with no doubt opposing views on today's game.
Yes, Michael, down here on the sideline, just sheltering from the rain at the moment. Two men who were, of course, players here for the last two finals. The recently retired Derek Ling of Kilkenny and Declan Fanning of Tip. Declan, maybe come to you first. Obviously, you're going for Tip to win. Why? How will they win it today?
Well, I feel, Claire, you know, that it's going to be a real physical battle, and the first 15 or 20 minutes, you know, is going to be really tough. And I suppose it'll maybe come down to the last 15, 20 minutes. I just feel the younger, fresher legs of Tipperary should pull away in the end.
Derek, as we know, Kilkenny do not like to be beaten. Can you see them being beaten twice in a row in a final?
Hopefully not. I think it's probably what's been driving them on all year, is to get a crack at Tipperary again in the All-Ireland final. And, you know, the way conditions are today is probably going to come down to a slip maybe or something like that. You know, it's going to be very greasy, I'd say. But, look, I think they're in a good frame of mind and they've prepared well. And, you know, I think they should do it. And hopefully they'll probably need a good start. But, you know, I think they have the freshness there and they haven't been tested too much this year, so hopefully that will stand to him today.
And not distractions this year. There's no five in a row. Henry's injury, very much distracting factors last year.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a lot more low-key this year. And like last year, you couldn't avoid it. And, you know, that's just the way it went. And, you know, unfortunately, Henry didn't last the game and I suppose didn't work out for us on the day. But, like, you know, hats off to Tipperary. They were brilliant. And, you know, regardless of Henry going off, I think they probably would have won it anyway. But look, at you know, today there's no excuses from both teams. So We'll know by 5 o'clock this evening anyway.
Declan, where is there going to be space today? Obviously, those Tipperary forwards need space. Where are they going to get it today?
Well, I think it's going to, it might suit Tipperary a bit better than it did against Dublin, because I don't think Kilkenny will drop a man back, you know, so it'll free up a lot of room. I suppose Kilkenny will be hoping to tighten up. I think their half back line will probably push back that little bit deeper into the full back line, you know, and they just won't want goals to go in like they did last year, you know, and they'll think they'll have a great chance then, you know, but I think people are questioning maybe Tipperary's hunger this year, and, you know, I'd feel they're very hungry for another All-Ireland, you know, one every 10 years. These players aren't happy with that, you know.
Okay, well, gentlemen, thank you for your thoughts. Of course, you're watching from the stands this year, unusually. Enjoy the game. That's it from the sideline for the moment, Michael.
Yeah, and it's going to be a little bit drier up in the stands than it is, obviously, down the sideline. A pity to see the umbrellas out here tomorrow.
It is, Michael, and the surface is very wet down there. And as Cheryl had mentioned, right, I mean, it gets more slippier here than actually giving way under your feet. So maybe a few mistakes could turn this game, you know. But, I mean, everybody is expecting this physical battle. I think tactically is going to be very, very key here as well. How far does he drop the half-back line back to actually stop that supply of ball going into the inside line of Lark Coburn and Dion Kelly's and John O'Brien? And will the Tipperary half-hour start coming more out the field and Brendan Cummins starts pinpointing puck out to them and it becomes a point-shooting match at that stage, you know? And they're the kind of tactical battles that are going to change the result of this match as well. And likewise at the other side. I mean, everybody's talking about maybe the star performer for Tipperary this year has been Padraig Maher. Who is going to take up the role of Patrick Maher? Who is going to stop him from launching those missiles into that full forward line? So they are some of the very key battles.
Liam Sheedy, can I come back again to Declan Ryan, who we saw in the interview a moment ago? When you finished up your term last year with Tipperary and you saw Declan and his backroom team coming in, were you happy enough with that move?
Definitely. Declan Ryan brings a huge experience into that role. I mean, Declan came in after me in 2007 as the minor manager, you know, so he knows all, as he said in the interview himself, he knows all of these young guys. He knows them very, very well, and he's played with some of them. So the amount of respect that Declan carries into a dressing room is top class. And likewise, you've got guys like Tommy Dunn and Michael Leeson. Michael Leeson is manager of Turles, who were, you know, unlucky not to even get to an Ireland Club All-Ireland last year, you know. And Tommy Dunn is, you know, people would say that he's one of the top coaches in the country, so he'll be putting them through their places. So, and like, you know, these guys as well, these players, you know, I think Declan Fanning said it there, they've won one All-Ireland in 10 years, so it's not as if they're used to winning. So like the hunger, okay, Kilkenny have the hurt of losing an All-Ireland final last year, but Tipperary have the hunger of only winning one All-Ireland every 10 years. So, you know, I think there's a huge driving factor for this Tipperary team here today.
All right, Liam, okay, we're headed for another break here on the programme. It's All-Ireland hurling final day, here today, and of course a member of that team is our own colleague here on the Sunday game, Tomás Mulcahy. And the manager of the losing Galway team, that occasion, of course, was Cyril Farrell. Tomás Mulcahy, you were nearly being left out of the team down there in Croke Park today. You had to make a quick dash in the studio. Yeah. Pity you weren't left out of the 86 team as well.
The run was a bit longer this time around to get to the field than it was in 86. You know? And Cyril, you remember...
No whistle blowing.
Cyril, I mean, you remember that result fairly well, you know. And I must say, I mean, we've been talking on for the last couple of weeks about all these tactics and the football and the blanket defence. I blame this man. He started on that way back in 1986 with his three-man midfield. Meanwhile, back at the man of the match function, Johnny Crowley, number four, and all-star that year, Johnny Crowley, number four. Sir,
you better answer.
Well, Johnny Crowley was a good player.
When you're giving him free bucks, when you're giving him free bucks, he's a great player.
You try something and it doesn't work. You do things and it does work. You know, we were coming from being trashed in 84. It was a young team, really, 85 and 86. We're just kind of getting to our feet. Cork were better than us in 86. The one that really killed me was the one in 1990 where they got all the score. Like, you know, that was because we were kind of around a while that time. But as Liam was saying, they're like, you win some and you lose some. And the funny thing is that the ones you lose, you remember a lot more than But again, going back to like the master's cracking the jokes, look at hurling is a great game, and I think it is a great affinity. Like the people that play it or following it, they're a little bit different in that they share everything. They share the skills. They don't keep any secrets. Like they try to win the game. Like you'd have the likes of Brian Cody and Sheedy and these guys going out to other counties, like spreading the gospel. Now, if they wanted to keep it just in Tipper Kilkenny, they wouldn't be spreading the gospel, and that's the way it should be. And like long may it live.
But I said, Michael, just the interesting thing there when you looked at the clip, four of Jimmy Barry Murphy's team going forward into his new selection committee for 2012. I mean, you've Joe Cunningham, Johnny Crowley, you've Kieran Kingston there that came on as a sub as well in 86 as well. So it shows a bit of continuity there. The guys that play the game are now getting a chance to put something back in as a Cork senior selector.
And that actually is an interesting point, Liam, that Cyril was making there. We refer to hurling people. You talk about them being hurling people regarding what county they come from, which you don't always hear we say about they being soccer people or rugby people with respect.
Yeah, I think it's something you grew up with, you know, and I mean, there's an awful lot of people, if you take Declan Ryan from when he started as a player to when he's the finished article, and likewise with Tommy Dunn, an awful lot of people have an impact on their careers. And it's great to see people like Declan Ryan and Tommy Dunn and these guys going back in and giving something back in either a manager's role or a coaching role. And I think it's hugely powerful. And that's one of the big strengths I think we have in the GAA. There's an awful lot of people giving the whole time.
And it's nearly demanded by the players that there's some sort of continuity from guys that played the game in the past that were involved at minor level at some stage, and they bring kids through the ropes at underage level and stuff like that, and they get their opportunity when it comes around.
There's one thing they have in Croke Park here today, Tomás, they didn't have 21 years ago when you were playing, and that's floodlights, and they have been switched on here at Croke Park, and I suppose that's indicative of the day here, because not only is it drizzling rain, as we can see from the picture there, but it's also quite a dull day here in Dublin, and there's a sort of grey sort of atmosphere over Croke Park, although I suspect certainly far that grey atmosphere will be lifted in a few minutes' time when the ball is thrown in.
I remember one famous time we were playing Kilkenny, you're talking to the boys on about the times they come out of the tunnel, and you get this time sheet and you have to follow it closely, but Kilkenny left, say, 2 minutes before us, four time, and the iron gate was down here in this corner here, it was locked, and they hit that gate such raps, it was like, but you'd have like a bomb coming, it couldn't get out, like, but it was all turmoil, like, and that can happen in a tunnel, like, now it's maybe more refined now, but like, things will happen that shouldn't happen, and like, it was very hard to go out and play, but like, when the ball is thrown in, that's the big thing. It's tough for teams hanging around and warm-ups, and everyone have their own little bit to do, and maybe everyone has their own little spot in the dressing room. But once you hit the pitch and once the ball is thrown in, it's all about getting the little white ball first. And I just hope today that they keep popping out new balls, because tomorrow said when he came back up, that the ground is very wet below. Like, at the minute when the grass is wet, no matter after a minute or so, the ball will get very heavy. So hopefully they'll keep popping out new balls that will keep flying around the place.
And Liam, this is the moment when the team start to emerge out, and there's no turning back from now.
No, the countdown is on in earnest now at this stage. You know, the teams are coming out onto the field. And again, it's a big occasion. I mean, most of the teams, or most of the players on both teams have been through this occasion before, so they know what to expect. And it is a little bit different, because you get maybe 20 minutes out and you got to shake hands and all this that goes on Ireland finally. So for the likes of John O'Keefe and Paul Murphy and Colin Finlay, guys that are having to deal with this for the first time, it's a big huge thing. You know, it is a big thing for a player. So you have to sort of prepare guys for that all the way up along, and you know, so that it doesn't just unnerve them, because it can unhinge them a little bit. So I'm sure for the new guys that are experiencing this for the first time, they'll be very anxious to get their hands on the ball and get that first puck in, and then you're in the rhythm, you're in the routine, and you're off, you know.
And that's a good point, because obviously when you look at teams as experienced as Tipperary are or Kilkenny are, and so many of those guys, like particularly on the Kilkenny side, have so many All-Ireland medals, but there's always that, as Liam said, one or two maybe newcomers will have to be sort of helped through this process.
Oh, geez, Michael, the key thing about All-Ireland finally, everybody, that the 15 players are around the field to start the match, everybody wants to be the hero, everybody wants to be the star performer, but it doesn't work out that way. I mean, 70 minutes will go very, very quickly for a lot of players today. They looked at maybe after the game if they had time to turn the clock back again. It's all about the 70 minutes now. A lot of hype last night that Brendan Maher would start for Tipperary, that Conlon Finlay mightn't make it for Kilkenny, and all that Eddie Brennan would be put back into the corner position. That doesn't seem to have materialised at the moment, that they're going as selected, you know. And interesting there is Eddie Brennan picked to play against Padraig Maher and stuff like that, and you'd be just thinking, is that on the basis that every time Brennan gets the ball, that he starts running out Padraig Maher and start turning him around, put him facing towards his own goal? So it's going to be very interesting in these type of conditions. Doing that, will it take an awful lot out of the legs?
Well, we've had no indication of any changes on either team, Cyril, so far, so presumably they're going to play as selected. Yeah. So now, as Small said, now it's a matter of who takes up who and what the little tactics are in the day.
And it doesn't matter how, when you have a goalie in, it's 14 against 14 out the pitch. And the lads are referring to the new guys, and it's a big occasion. But I found the players, your 10th time in, if you got in the 10th time, was actually bigger because than the first time, because you actually knew what was at stake. It was kind of, it could get you. And the big thing is, really, you're going to be tense. Every fella have different ways of expressing it, but the big thing is once you hit the pitch to release that, you know what I mean, and get the feel of the ball. Now the sooner that happens, the better. And no one wants to make a mistake, but you'll find that the person that goes gets the first touch and go for broke. In All-Ireland final, you have to go for broke, and sometimes you'll do things that you might never do again. And I just hope with these wet conditions that there's no one that a reckless tackle, someone doesn't get a red card. I hate to see someone down to 40 minutes, because it will be slippy conditions, and no matter what cogs they've in, it's going to be fairly hectic, because lads will be going in at 100 miles an hour. But whoever puts their print in the game, Kilkenny will be trying to establish themselves from the very, very beginning. And it will be interesting to see who picks up who. You know, usually with Brian Cody, he likes to get Henry Shefflin on the new guy, so he'll be on John O'Keefe in the backs. Yeah. And as Tomás referred to there, with Eddie Brennan, most unlikely that he'd be wing forward. He might, but the way the modern days anyway, everyone kind of switches around. Tip will be doing the very same thing, be switching all over the place. If Noel McGrath into forward, Bonner Maher in there, Seamus Cannon out again. There'll be all movement. So it's like cat and mouse, but when the ball is in, someone's going to catch, some cat is going to catch the mouse, whoever's going to be.
course, now, Liam, well, the other thing that we have is once the teams come out and you have the cheer of the crowd and you run out onto the pitch and crupper, you have that kind of lull period that takes place now for the next while, the warm-ups, the meeting the president, the parade and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, but it's all done minute by minute. You know, I mean, you know, Keane O'Neill will know what he's doing for the next 10 minutes on that pitch. And, you know, likewise, then they know when they need to go over and if they need to go back in for a toilet break as well before they go. Because there is a long time, you know, they're taking liquids on to make sure they don't get dehydrated throughout the day. So it is important that they're ready to go. But, you know, it's all building nicely for the throw-in at 3:30. And I just, you know, I think we're all waiting in anticipation of what's going to take place in the next 70 minutes.
Well, the anticipation all over the country is huge at this stage, Tomás.
Well, it is, Michael, and isn't it fantastic? You know, we're all hurling people, but for all sports people, isn't it a fantastic occasion? And if there isn't nerves or butterflies inside the belly, there's something wrong. Whether you're a young guy or whether you're an older guy, this is the biggest stage of an amateur player's career that he can play on, the highest level that he can play on. Brian Crowdy all week has been hyping an awful lot of pressure on the Tipperary boys, and he was saying about the Kilkenny guys, sure, what else would they be doing? They're doing what they love to do best, is play on the biggest stage, and hopefully that lives up to their expectations.
Okay, time to head over to the commentary box. Ger Canning and Michael Dignan are there to describe this afternoon's big match. But right now, they're going to take us through the team lineups. Ger.
Michael, after two of the most compelling finals in living memory, well, we're looking forward to what we hope will be maybe the third part of that particular group of meetings to determine best of three, as it were. And let's take a check through to see who's going to win today and who's going to start. Starting with the Leinster champions, they start the final with six changes from last year. Among them, goalkeeper David Herity from Dunamagan. Paul Murphy at right corner back is another experiencing this stage of the championship for the first time after a really good season so far. Team captain Brian Hogan had the misfortune to miss last year's classic final through injury. Today, he lines up as usual at centre-half back. Michael Fennelly in midfield has been having his best season at this level. He's listed to start with Michael Rice, who was a sub last year. Eddie Brennan is programmed to start on the wing in a line which includes Richie Power and Henry Shefflin. And up front, Colin Fennelly, who might well be switched, partners Owen Larkin and Richie Hogan. As you say, alongside me here is Michael Dignan. Who do you want to focus on, Michael?
Well, Michael Fennelly, to me, has been key for Kilkenny this year. Outstanding athlete. I think the way they have to play today, he's going to have to drop back, help the half-back line and the full-back line, but also get forward, and he's, you know, averaging 2 or 3 points a game as well. So, to me, he's a key man for Kilkenny today.
Well, what about Tipperary, the defending champions, with goalkeeper Brendan Cummins set to start his 67th championship match. What a goalkeeper he has been down the years. The full back line shows Paul Curran lining up with Paddy Stapleton and Michael Cahill. And then in front of them is an All-Ireland final newcomer in John O'Keefe, while on the other flank, a possible hurler of the year, of course, in Pádraig Maher. Shane McGrath plays centre field for the third year in a row, this time with Garrod Ryan in tandem. Tip have resisted making change of the half-forward line, with Seamus Callanan replaced against Dublin at half-time, starting once again. And in the full forward line, team captain Owen Kelly carries much of the threat, along with last year's top performer, that's corner forward, Lar Corbett. Michael, your thoughts.
Well, Pádraig Maher, the left half-back for Tipperary, to me, has been the key man this year. He was outstanding all year, but the last day against Dublin chose not to puck any ball in the whole game out his wing, but he still exerted a huge influence on the game, ended up scoring 2 points in play. And I think, you know, you'll see Kilkenny just trying to puck the ball down on top of John O'Keefe and probably Henry Shefflin, and trying to keep Pádraig Maher out of the game, because he is a huge, huge influence on this Tipperary team.
Thanks indeed, Michael. Well, will it be two in a row for Tipperary, or will the Cats extract their own retribution? They're the greatest of rivals, usually the best of friends. Just not this afternoon, Michael.
Yeah, perhaps not. Not for the next hour or two anyway, Ger, that's for sure. One of the things that we've seen time and time again, Liam Sheedy from Kilkenny, is when you think that they might be in a big challenge under pressure, people talk about their form and so forth, Leinster finally against Dublin, they come out and they blow teams away in the first half of the match.
Yeah, they're experts at it. You know, they really want to make their stamp on the match very, very early on. You know, it is definitely a pattern they've had again this year. I think definitely they set out to stall. I mean, in their first game against Wexford, you know, very early on, they got the goal. Richie Hogan got it.
Just wasn't good enough on the day. Then they upped it the following year in terms of intensity. And that's been impressive. And it seems to be there again this year.
Yeah, and that's the reason they were successful against Kilkenny, Michael, last year. Because Liam mentioned, and I'm going counteracting his argument on the basis of the Kilkenny intensity in that first half period, where they go for the jugger and they push on very much in the 21st 20 minutes. Tipperary last year, look at the hits, right? Everybody, 3, 4, 5 men chasing down the ball, giving no space, denying them the opportunities, getting the hoops in, getting the blocks in. And if that level of intensity isn't there for Tipperary today, they will struggle in this game. I would expect it to be there on the basis of Liam said that these guys will not be happy with one All-Ireland medal in 10 years. So if you're reigning champions and you want to go on further, you've got to increase the intensity levels today. And that's what I'd expect out of Tipperary. I mean, from their full back line out, right out to midfield, non-stop action and being in Kilkenny's faces and taking the game to Kilkenny rather than waiting for...
Flanked by JJ Delaney, of course, and Tommy Walsh, two incredibly important players.
Yeah, any halfback like Michael in any team, but like on the Kilkenny team, if they play well, Kilkenny play well. Like Tommy Walsh, these are great players. Tommy Walsh is a small player, but he's immaculate in there, and he always does the right thing with the ball. He's always in the thick of the action. Here again, like this is Michael Finlay, a big, strong. Now they seem to link up a lot with this Michael Finlay, and like again the crowd out attack. You're going to see here a little flick back here. Like these guys on song, they're Welsh, you know, Delaney. Brian Hogan, they're big strong players. Now Hogan was missing last year, and like you know, he drives again, linking up with Michael Finlay and bang it off. They do that seemingly, it doesn't happen by accident, it happens the whole time. They have a kind of a certain plan with it at this stage. This is Hogan here bursting through. Now there's not much you can do here for Walker. He just goes up the middle, he finds himself gone way up the field and pucks it over the bar. He was missing last year, and like there's a lot of talk about him being absent, but this guy is a very, very forceful player, and you'll find they will probably come back a small bit to help the full back line. And if they play well, Tip could be in trouble, but they're the real engine of the team. Now they have a lot of mileage on the hurling clock, but like, there could be one big one left in them.
Brian Hogan, of course, is the Kilkenny captain as well. Old Kelly, the Tipperary captain. They've had the toss there a few minutes ago. We understand that Kilkenny won the toss, as far as I could see, anyway. And I think they're going to play from left to right as we are watching. Referee Brian Gavin there as well, of course.
Yeah, again, you know, the toss is in, and you know, Owen Kelly, I think, to me, has been majestic in the last two finals. I mean, you know, being involved in 2009, to see what the guy had went through with his back, I think he got 14 or 15 injections into his lower back, and to see the performance that guy brought, it was probably a man of the match performance, only for Tip didn't win the game, you know. Yes. And again, last day, you know, Jackie Turrell is a top class player, but 7 times he went out and stood over freeze, and 7 times he put the ball over the bar. And, you know, when Henry was gone, like Kilkenny did miss a few, it could have been back to 2 or 3 points with 5 minutes to go if Henry was still on the pitch. So Owen is going to be key. I think Owen's performance generally drives, you know, it sort of sets the tone for the team. So he'll be very, very important.
I mean that is a crucial point, because I mean they did struggle there, Michael, the last day, particularly in their half hour line Tipperary. I mean there was 2 or 3 of them substituted, right? Because realistically Dublin were on top. I know Dublin had an extra man back in defence. But when you're not on top in your half hour line against this Kilkenny half back line, it means there's no supply going into the inside line, you know. So I mean that is crucial. I mean Owen Kelly isn't the quickest on his feet, right? I mean, he's not getting any younger, right? So he tries on ball straight at him, not out into corner, straight at him, that he can actually get his body around the defender and win possession. And that is crucial for Tipperary today.
Well, Tomas, even the last day, his free taking is immaculate. Like, you know, he stands over the 65s or odd feet, pops them all over. Now, if you have a guy that can score from midfield in all the time, it means you're still in the game if you don't concede goals. And he's doing that the whole time. And like, he has gone a bit slower, but his brain hasn't gone slower.
No, there's no doubt about that. And in actual fact, it's amazing looking at for guys like him, for Brendan Cummins or for Lara Corbett. You know, it's like buses. You don't see an All-Ireland medal for 10 years, and then there's a prospect of two coming along together.
Yeah, like, these guys, you know, the Lara and, say, and Kelly and Brendan Cummins have won All-Ireland way back. And you'd imagine they're winning a lot in between. But all they have, like, you know, it's a good bit. They have 2 All-Irelands. But when you look at the Kilkenny boys, they all have buckets lost them. So they are mad to win because they haven't won as much as they feel that they should have won. And this... Take out the 3 or 4 older guys that are around on the team. This is a very, very young Tipperary team. If they can win today, they can be the real new force. They can be the Kilkenny of the hurling world.
That'll be a driving force.
Absolutely driving force. Yeah, you know, as I said, you know, they only have 1 in 10. You know, it's a huge driving factor for these guys. You know, Larry and Owen and Brendan, they'll probably look back over the last 10 years and say, we missed opportunities here. We could have had more silverware. So now they've got a chance. The young lads have come in. The young lads have brought the training and everything to a new level in there, because they were winning minors in 06 and 07. So it's all fitting very, very nicely together. But as you said, they're starting to shove on the wrong side of 30 now. So they'll be anxious to get another All-Ireland medal here today. But they're going to have to earn it.
We talk with admiration about Owen Kelly, what he's had to go through, the back injuries and so on. But Henry Shefflin, we saw him a moment ago there. When he hobbled off the field to us 12 months ago, we wondered, would we see him again?
I mean, I have so much admiration for this guy as an individual on and off the field, but as a hurler, right? And I mean, we saw last year there was a change in tempo with Kilkenny when he went off the field, right? I mean, he is their leader of the attack. He is their playmaker. Everything goes through him, whether it's from freeze or open play. And they just... the brain power that he has to spot guys in different positions, in scoring positions, and the unselfishness of his play. And he is key to Kilkenny today, no doubt about that. You could talk about the Owen Larkins and the Richie Hogans and Richie Power. Yes, they're key as well. But if Shefflin begins this game well, and he gets into his stride early, they can cause serious problems for that Tipperary backline.
Liam Sheedy, you don't want to see any player hobble off the field in the All-Ireland final, but I'm sure when you saw that last year, you knew that was a boost to your team. You had to.
We had always planned that there was a chance that maybe Henry or John Tennyson
or John Tennyson, yeah, the other.
You know, sometimes you know, inside your head, you could get a little bit weak. You know, so I mean, I think Eamon O'Shea was very busy flying around the field to make sure they don't drop the tempo here, because that can happen. You know, because sometimes players will come up an extra 10% when they see a guy like Henry Shefflin, because Tomás rightly points out he's a huge asset to any team. He's one of the best hurlers of all time. You know, he's a magician really around his hurling field. And even the last day, I think, I was surprised actually he stayed in the half forward line all the time the last time, because he's whether it was just to get him that little bit more match fit or whatever, because I think he'd be a real danger in around the goals as well. So
I think they keenly will admit in Kilkenny, it was a mistake starting him last year, right? And you'd ask about Conall Finley as well, with his hamstring injury and stuff like that, maybe didn't take full part in training over the last number of weeks. Are they taking another gamble with the likes of Conall Finley with a hamstring?
Okay, well, the distinguished guest here
and coaches.
Yeah, absolutely. Particularly Tipperary, I think, with a younger team. The Kilkenny lads have been around a long time, but I think, maybe been overlooked a little bit. A lot of changes on the Kilkenny team this year. David Herity coming in goals in a difficult day like today, windy and rain, it's hard for him. Paul Murphy, relatively inexperienced, and Colin Fennelly. But the nerves that go out the window, usually once you get on the first ball, the first tackle, you forget about it. And both teams look very relaxed. See Declan Ryan smiling there as well. So, brilliant atmosphere, two great teams, and I'm really, really looking forward to it.
Well, the build-up has been full of the usual hyperbole, not necessarily among the players, but certainly among the fans. It's been enthralling, it's been fascinating. Everybody's wanted to be here, and I know the county board officials in Kilkenny and Tip have done their best to get as many people into Croke Park as they possibly could, and they've been asked me to wish people who can't be here greetings to Conor Dunphy in Qatar, to Dara Hickey, who's watching in Toronto, and Tucker and Paul Kerwin watching in Sydney. Hope you're watching it everywhere and anywhere and going to enjoy it. Just listen to the cheer. Kilkenny won by 5 points in 2009, Tip by 8 last September. And many are now seeing this final as a decider in a best of three. The match referee is Brian Gavin from Clara in County Offaly. His first All-Ireland final gets underway. It's the 123rd. So will it be a blue and gold year? Or will it be black and amber once again? On as far as Colin Fennelly from the pass by Richie Power. Trying to cut it out here, Paul Curran. Hand passing it snappily there into the middle, into Garrow and Ryan to get it downfield. But only as far as the Kilkenny 65-metre line. Meeting it there was Michael Rice, sending it back in once again in towards Owen Larkin, who started at full forward. Questions about that were being asked beforehand. Out once again it comes via Conor O'Mahony, out into the centre. Once again taken up here by Kilkenny, this time by Michael Fennelly, about whom there was a slight doubt this morning. Usual rumours going, doing the business. That's out as far as Henry Shefflin, trying to get the opening score for Kilkenny here, being bottled up there by Tipperary. Two men go out to him. Eventually, it comes out here towards Colin Fennelly. Fennelly going forward, and the referee has blown his whistle. It's got to be a free in. Or is that going to be the case? Yes, the referee signalling that it's going to be a free.
Yeah, George, just looking at the Kilkenny backline there, Tommy Walsh picked up Larry Carver from the throw-in, but he's now after coming back out onto the wing, and Brian Hogan has gone back in on him. J.J. Delaney has gone on the other wing, and Jackie Terrell's at centre-back. Oh, Jackie Terrell's on Larry Carver, sorry. All over the place.
That was going to be the big question, wasn't it? Yeah. Who was going to pick up Larry?
Well, Jackie Terrell is on him, Tommy Walsh is back out on the wing, he was in the corner, and they're all moving all over the place.
That was rumoured, Michael. Here's Henry Shefflin from 30 metres out. Straight as it possibly could be, over the bar. He gets the opening score from the free there. Some of the fans who've been well and truly drenched from the earlier showers. Yeah, rain is easing a bit now. It's the first time I can remember the floodlights been on here, Michael,
that's
for an All-Ireland final.
We've John O'Brien at wing forward. Seamus Callan in the corner, Owen Kelly full. So positions again not mean anything except that Bronner Maher is on Tommy Walsh.
That's plucked out there. Inside towards John O'Brien, the man you were talking about. trying to get it back into the middle there, looking for Shane McGrath, runs back again towards Lark Corbett, almost on the sideline, and the linesman over there, who's Barry Kelly, raises his flag. Lark had stepped out, it's got to be a line ball for Kilkenny. Kilkenny won the toss and have opted to play from left to right in the first half. Let's watch it again here. Lark just running out of space, very judicious shoulder coming in as well, helping him out. As regards the breeze, well, because of the rain, the breeze has died down quite significantly. Really is no wind around. Into the middle it comes here. Should have been taken by Shane McGrath, picked up instead by Eddie Brennan. Sent in well towards Larkin. Owen Larkin stealing a march on his man. Larkin, what a good dispossession there, Michael Cahill across. Comes out towards John O'Keefe. Challenged there once again by Henry Shefflin. A really good opportunity. And a wonderful piece of defending.
Absolutely, and Gerard, crucially, Eddie Brennan, I'm surprised, you know, 33 years of age to start wing forward, but look at Michael Cahill coming across there. And I've heard people in the build-up to the game talking about maybe Michael Cahill not being as good as last year, but I think he's vital. He's carrying an injury into the game, but I think he's a vital cog in that Tipperary full-back line, and he saw it there.
Yeah, he got an ankle injury in training during the week. Pass fit to play, however. Brendan Cobbins taking this free. Big one down towards Lark Corbett, runs on beyond him. Going in to collect it is Brian Hogan. Under a little bit of pressure, helped out by Michael Fennelly. Huge one, 60 metres way down the park once again. Coming out to collect it, Owen Larkin. He's got a couple of possessions. Looks at the target, fires it over his left shoulder and puts it over the bar. First point to come from play. Second for Kilkenny. They've made a very good start.
The half journey, you see there, Michael Fennelly picking up a ball just about 40 yards from his own goal. He's dropping back, helping the half-back line. And Owen Larkin is causing Paul Curran all sorts of troubles. And as I was just saying there, Eddie Brennan at 33 out on Pádraic Maher. You know, a man with a fantastic record in Ireland finals, and he looks up for it as well. And Kilkenny have made a great start.
It's been a very good week for him. His wife gave birth to baby Harry during the week. So well done to Eddie Brennan. Congratulations to the Brennan family. And he's in the starting 15 as well. Right now it's Tipperary with Garo O'Dryan trying to take ball out of the tip half of the field, trying to make some headway here. Well defended once again, Michael Rice this time, sending it back up towards Colin Fennelly, losing it. Michael Cahill coming back out. Michael Rice raising the stick for it, but runs on towards Noel McGrath, slipping the hand pass across there, helped on by Shane McGrath, down into the corner towards the captain, can't get there. But Owen Kelly does give a shoulder to Jackie Tyrrell, runs towards Seamus Caldon now. Caldon on his hands and knees, the number 10 for Tipperary. Everybody appealing for it, and the linesman says it's got to be a line ball for Tip. Hectic start, as you'd expect in the All-Ireland final. Seamus Caldon there, Tip's third highest scorer this year in the championship, challenged by JJ Delaney. Ended up eventually going off the Kilkenny player. Line ball, so to the All-Ireland champions. And the man who's going across to take it is Noel McGrath, the 20-year-old from Lochmore Castellini. And he is well capable of putting it over from most sideline angles, but hardly this one here. He's almost up against the corner flag. Referee is going to have to go in here because there's a little set two between Seamus Caldon and his marker there. And referee Brian Gavin, for whom this is naturally a huge honour, taking charge, going in to have a word with JJ Delaney and with the Tipperary player. From the line ball, it might go back, it's gone out over the end line, it's gone for the game's first 65. So an opportunity then for Tipperary to get their first score.
Yeah, and I think they'll be glad of a little breather there over the last minute. Kilkenny started at a ferocious pace. Really look up for the game. Look a lot fresher than last year. See JJ Delaney and Seamus Callan there digging away. And Brian Gavin, you know, referee that renowned for letting the game flow. But I think, you know, he'd also be capable of, if a bad lad did pull a dirty stroke early on, you know, he would be capable of taking decisive action. So I think players want to be careful out there.
Well, he'd also want to put down a marker, won't he?
Absolutely.
To make sure
But the game has been so fast, I don't think there's been much time for anyone to get involved in it. The ball has been flying up and down the field since the start.
So it's the turn of Owen Kelly then to take this 65. You can see it's much further out than 65 metres because of the angle he's confronted with. So on a pretty still afternoon at Croke Park, Tipperary looking for their opening score in this final. Owen Kelly hitting it. Has it got the necessary accuracy? Not quite. Gone to the left. But it was a very, very difficult shot. There's Declan Ryan, who's won All-Ireland medals in three different decades, 89, 91, and of course 10 years ago, 2001, when Owen Kelly was a teammate. David Herity pucking it out. Up towards Henry Shevlin, trying to put the pressure maybe on John O'Keefe, the least experienced member of that Tipperary defence. Nicely out of difficulty there by John O'Brien. Up towards Seamus Calman, turned well, 45 metres out. Seamus Calman running into traffic, leaving the ball behind him, however, and JJ gets it away down the field. Taken by the other number seven, Porrick Maher. Falls, but he gives it out to Michael Cahill. Good link-up play, gets it to Garrow and Ryan. Once again, putting the pressure there on the Kilkenny full back line. And it'll be interesting to see just how much cover they managed to bring back there. Tommy Walsh will be attempting to shore it up much better than happened last year when they yielded four goals. Here's Garrod Ryan running into Michael Fennelly again. Fennelly pursuing Porrick Maher there, trying to get to it. In the end, Garrod Ryan very busy in the match so far. Back to Conor O'Mahony, the centre half back. Way down. Calden beaten for it, once again taken by the wing-back, JJ Delaney from the Fenians, huge one up. Nicely across towards Colin Fennelly, and the 22-year-old hand passes it forward, was intended there for Henry Shefflin, reading it well was Porrick Maher, slipping it back outside to Michael Cahill, and the UCC student drives it a good 60 metres down the park. Picked up here this time by the newcomer for Kilkenny, Paul Murphy, the Army man getting into the centre. Again, it's Garrow and Ryan, busy as ever. Challenged there by Eddie Brennan. Brennan picking it up, going to his left. Slipping it forward. Hefty shoulder on Richie Hogan. Still managed to get it forward towards Eddie Brennan. Surrounded by Tipperary players. One of the Porrick Maher rolls it up beautifully. Controls it neatly. Slipping out of the hands of Lar Corbett. Bouncing back to Brian Hogan, who's the Kilkenny captain, of course. This time picking it up very, very low there and doing well is Paul Curran. And the Mullinahome man needing John O'Keefe alongside him just to complete the clearance. Early stages of this final. It's going to drop down there between Tommy Welch and Patrick Bollermaher. Watch for that duel. Comes back out to Garrod Ryan again. Looks neat. It's going to drop short. Goalkeeper under pressure. Player in the square. And it's going to be a free out.
Well, Gerard, the big difference I see so far is Kilkenny forwards are working so hard. Colin Fennelly's pace, that's why he was so important. He's causing havoc. They're tackling very hard, and Tipperary have been forced to play high ball into the forward line. Last year you saw them playing low ball into space. This year they've been hurried. And Brian Hogan is sitting right back in front, moving back and covering for his full back line. And at the moment, all the Kilkenny backs are well on top of the tip forwards.
I was just mentioning, Michael, there, that duel between Tommy Welch and Patrick Bonner-Maher. The Bonner really did a very good job on Tommy Welch last year.
Well, he did. He dragged him all over the field. But I think Tommy, you know, is playing more orthodox, staying in his position this year. And, you know, he carried an injury into last year's final two. But at the moment, I'd say all the Kilkenny backs on top. JJ Delaney back in the corner. Paul Murphy out in the wing. And Noel Hickey on Owen Kelly as well in there. And Kilkenny going very well.
Kilkenny going well. Tip still looking for their opening point in this match. And we're in the 11th minute already. And again, it's the backs of Kilkenny doing well. That time, Noel Hickey firing it away down the field, up towards Larkin once again. Got an unkind bounce there. Out comes Brendan Cummins. Slipping it back out here on this near side. Michael Rice watching it. So too is Garrod Ryan, who's been as tight as he possibly can to Michael Rice. The duels there have been very tasty. Line ball to be taken by the player who teaches at St. Kieran's College. Same nursery in Kilkenny, of course. Up towards Larkin, will bounce neatly in front of him here, causing a lot of problems, getting a lot of possession. That was a difficult one for any of his colleagues to take, but it might work yet for Richie Hogan. Tries to make space for himself. Man, he got two goals in the first half of the semi-final. Fires this one beautifully over the bar. That's a lovely point. Usually a very lively customer, Richie Hogan from Daneford. Beautifully taken.
Absolutely, and Owen Larkin again with an assist there out in front of Paul Curran, and he's won three or four balls. But all over the field, you'd have to say that Kilkenny are winning every battle. Their first touch is very good, and they look so hungry. And, you know, Tipperary really need a score to settle them at this stage.
Well, it was always going to be interesting just to see who would settle down in this match first, and it definitely has been the Cats. Michael Fennelly that time sending it way up there. Again, Richie Hogan angling this one beautifully in. Goalkeeper comes out. It's on the line and it's safe from going over the line. Paul Curran got it away, but Owen Larkin had Brendan Cummins in real difficulty that time. A tantalising ball back to time. This time it's Tommy Walsh getting it back here to Henry Shefflin, shooting it from 65 metres out, and he's put it to the right. But the place is still buzzing about that very, very near thing there for Owen Larkin.
Yeah, and Ger, the thing there is that ball was played in by Richie Hogan into Owen Larkin. Stopped there, you can see clearly stopped by Paul Curran. But Richie Hogan did attempt to play the ball in. Tommy Walsh with another great catch there. You see it here, just stopped on the line.
You have to admire the composure of Paul Curran to go back that time.
He was very cool, but Richie Hogan actually picked out Owen Larkin in just about a yard of space in behind Paul Curran, and Tommy Walsh with two great catches, and he won another free there.
So Kilkenny much the happier in the opening quarter of an hour of this match. This free hit forward here by Paul Murphy. It's going to drop around 20 metres out. Gathered in well there by Porrick Maher once again, slipping the hand pass out to Shane McGrath, yet to exert a real influence on this game, and he's hand passed it away to Michael Rice, slipping it back out towards Richie Power, has a support player outside, but he doesn't need him, hitting it off his left hand side and drilling it over the bar. What a start this is for the Cats. They were the outsiders in the minds of many, many people before.